Let's stand together, shall we? 295, revive us again. Alleluia, thank the glory. Alleluia, amen. Alleluia, thank the glory. Revive us again. We praise thee, O God, for the sign of thy glory, for Jesus who died and is now gone above. Alleluia, thank the glory. Alleluia, amen. Alleluia, thank the glory. Revive us again.
Ladies only.
Let's have a proud man. Alleluia, thank the glory. Alleluia, amen. Alleluia, thank the glory. Revive us again.
Men only.
Oh, glory and praise to the Lamb that was slain, who has borne all our sins and has cleansed every stain. Alleluia, thank the glory. Alleluia, amen. Alleluia, thank the glory. Revive us again. Revive us again. Fill its heart with thy love. May its soul be rekindled with fire from above. Alleluia, thank the glory. Alleluia, amen. Alleluia, thank the glory. Revive us again.
Say hallelujah.
Hallelujah, thank the glory. Hallelujah, amen. Hallelujah, thank the glory. Revive us again.
And then remain standing, please remain standing. I have been advised that if anyone has any dishes or kitchen utensils that is your personal property, then you need to pick them up from the fellowship hall this morning. If you do not pick them up, your property will become the church's property. So today is the last day for you to claim them. We're going to write Grace Bible Church and everything over there tomorrow. So it's yours, you can pick it up. Amen?
Amen.
Hey, let's bow together for prayer, shall we? Eternal God, our Father, we thank you for this grand privilege. Once more time, get together in this consecrated, sanctified, set-apart place with those of like precious faith, that we might humble ourselves before you and to acknowledge your transcendent power and glory, and ascribe your honor and glory and blessing and might and privilege, for you and you alone are worthy. So, Father, we pray that you would rend the heavens one more time, that you would come down, and that you would meet with your people, that you would fill us with your Holy Spirit, that you would dance from heart to heart and breast to breast, that you would manifest yourself with great heaviness in this place. For everyone here who's come with a worn or tired spirit will sense the presence of the living God flowing fresh upon them, reviving them, cleansing them, and purging them, and washing them, and lifting their spirits again. That person who's never come to faith in Christ might sense the great love of God, the overwhelming, irresistible grace of God, leading them to repentance toward God and faith in the Lord Jesus Christ. That a person who is lonely and depressed and discouraged might realize they have a friend in Jesus and will stick closer than a brother. That young person who senses peer pressure might recognize that God will swallow up inside of them in a mighty way, enabling them to resist the onslaught of the evil one. We pray, O God, for it, you might move today, we might know that we've been in the presence of the living God. And we might leave this place like the men on the mess road, say, surely in our heart burn within us. As God himself manifested himself and took his word and applied it to our hearts, our minds, our souls, and our spirits, that God himself impressed himself upon us in such a profound way that we know beyond shadow of doubt that he's real. Do it, Father, for your own glory. Do it, Lord, for the furtherance of your own kingdom. Do it, Father, so that your people might shine forth as light in the midst of this crooked and perverse nation, and they might extend the word of life. We'll be careful to give your name the praise, honor, and glory. You and you alone are worthy. In Jesus' name. Amen. Remain standing, please, for the public reading of God's word. I would invite your attention this morning to 1 Corinthians chapter 12. Young people threw us a curve this morning. We really wanted to sort of honor them, share a good word of encouragement to them. But since they're not here, we thought we had better prepare something else because they might not show up. And we will save that for when they come. 1 Corinthians chapter 12. Look with me, if you would please, at verse 1. Now concerning spiritual gifts, brethren, I do not want you to be unaware. You know that when you were pagans, you were led astray to the dumb idols, however you were led. Therefore, I make known to you that one speaking by the Spirit of God says Jesus is accursed, and no one can say that Jesus is Lord except by the Holy Spirit. Now there are a variety of gifts, but the same Spirit. And there are a variety of ministries and the same Lord. And there are a variety of effects of the same God who works all things in all persons. But to each one is given manifestation of the Spirit for the common good. For to one is given the word of wisdom through the Spirit, and to another the word of knowledge according to the same Spirit, to another faith by the same Spirit, to another gifts of healing by the one Spirit, and to another the effecting of miracles, and to another prophecies, and to another the distinguishing of spirits, to another various kinds of tongues, and to another the interpretation of tongues. But one and the same Spirit works all these things, distributing to each one individually, just as he wills. For even as the body is one, and yet has many members, and all the members of the body, though they are many, are one body, so also is Christ. For by one Spirit we were all baptized into one body, whether Jews or Greeks, whether slaves or free, and were all made to drink of one Spirit. For the body is not one member, but many. May the Lord just bless me to his word that we sanctify in our hearts. May you see. I want to speak to you this morning from the subject of the unity in the body of Christ. The unity in the body of Christ. As I shared with you earlier, last week I had a great privilege of being in Richmond, Virginia with my brothers and sisters. Every time we gather together, my heart is greatly warmed and I'm greatly encouraged to be reminded that I'm not here by myself. There is the same blood that's running through my veins as running through the veins of all the folk who are trying to serve the Lord. As I shared at a Baccalaureate service earlier in the week, as we were going down toward Richmond, we came across a little place called Gooseland County, Virginia. And my father used to often talk about Gooseland County. I thought he was saying Gooseland County. But he was talking about Gooseland County, Virginia, because that's where our ancestors were from. And one of my cousins, Reverend Leonard Payne, went to Gooseland County, Virginia some years ago and went to the courthouse and looked at all the court records and was able to trace back our roots to a slave plantation there. So a man by the name of Humphrey Payne, who was born a slave to an English slaveholder who happened to be his father, and who was given his freedom when he became an adult. And from his offspring, the next generation decided that Gooseland County wasn't a good place to be. So they decided to move on a little bit further north and a little bit further west. And so they landed in a little place called Mount Hope, West Virginia. My father actually lived and died a quarter of a mile from where he was born. You know, he got very far up north from home, right? And up it was called Turkey Knob, where he lived back up in this hollow. Recently paved the road for many years, and he had a paved road. And he went to school about a quarter of a mile away from that, over what's called Sugar Creek, over in the bottom. And he never ventured very far away from home, except a brief military stint, and then back to Mount Hope, he came. But as I was going to Virginia and going through Goosland County and thinking about all the people that had gone before, and my heart was being really energized by the fact I would see my brothers and sisters that I don't get to see a lot. And to sense this energy when you come around family, of being a part of something bigger than yourself. And it seems like the older we get, the more we start looking like each other. You know, you start looking at folks, they start looking like you. You think you're looking in the mirror and you realize you're a part of something that's larger than you, larger than just any one individual. And so the success of one family member, we all can share. And the burdens and the tears, the pain, the frustration, the agony of one family member, we all can bear. That's what the family is supposed to operate. And that's what God wants the church to be a family. To be uniquely and distinctly the people of God. In this crooked and perverse nation world in which we live, where people are self-centered and narcissistic and preoccupied with their own little world, God wants the people of God's hearts to be tenderized by the pain and by the suffering of the brothers and sisters in Christ. He wants us to be extending ourselves and spending ourselves to minister to others, that we might show the world that God has indeed called out of the world, out of this cold, callous, and cruel world. God has called people, has called the church, the Christians, those who follow the Lord. Amen. And they're living out their faith and these discipleship relationships with each other. And they're trying to care for each other and bury their burdens and pray for one another and put up with each other and help each other be what God intended for them to become. Amen. That's what Paul was writing to the church at Corinth about. The church at Corinth had some serious problems because they had tremendous intellectual prowess, but they were somewhat short in spirituality. They had the greatest teachers of the New Testament era, the skilled orator, Apollos, the great theologian Paul, the apostle Peter, all visited Corinth, and they all instructed them there. And so they had become somewhat spiritually big-headed, thinking that knowledge and spirituality were the same thing. And so even though they had all the doctrine right, they had all the knowledge right, but in terms of how they were relating to each other, there was a great inconsistency. It was incongruent. There was bickering, there was envying, there was strife, they were competing with each other. And so they were not living up to the knowledge and the theology that they had been exposed to. So the Apostle Paul, relentlessly in 1 Corinthians, is trying to correct many errors that existed in the church. And the major error that seemed to permeate and to influence everything was the dissension that was there, the spirit of competition. And so Paul is trying to deal with that. And so when he comes to 1 Corinthians 12, he uses a metaphor of the body, that the church, the people of God, ought to be a body that's working in a complementary relationship with each other rather than in competition. Now, many people look at 1 Corinthians 12, and they want to quickly move to this idea that Paul is teaching about spiritual gifts. Well, I believe in 1 Corinthians 12, Paul is really using spiritual gifts as a way of illustrating the body of Christ. He was not trying to delineate all the spiritual gifts that God has given to the church, but he was using spiritual gifts as an illustration as to how the body is supposed to function. But look at what he says. He says, concerning spiritual gifts, brother, I do not want you to be unaware. You know you were led by pagans, worshiping dumb idols. And then in verse 4, he says that there are a variety of gifts but the same Spirit, and there are a variety of ministers but the same Lord, and there are a variety of effects but the same God who works all things in all persons. Now, from those verses, you can see that Paul is getting ready to launch into a treatise on this idea of the unity that should exist in the body of Christ. There in those verses, he introduces, without explaining, the concept of the Trinity. Now, some people don't believe that the Bible teaches the doctrine of the Trinity, but it's clear that it does teach it. It doesn't explain it in terms of how it works, but it teaches it. Look at it right here. In those verses 4, 5, and 6, Paul talked about a variety of gifts, but the same Spirit. Variety of ministries, but the same Lord. Variety of effects, but the same God. There in those 3 verses, Paul introduces God the Holy Spirit, God the Son, the Lord Jesus Christ, and God the Father. And what he's trying to point out, that there's unity within the Trinity. There's unity within the Godhead. God is not divided. God is not competing against himself in the Godhead. There's God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit. One God, eternally self-existing, but manifesting himself in 3 distinct personalities, as God the Father, as God the Son, as God the Holy Spirit. And so here, what Paul is showing them is that there's unity in the Godhead. Even though there is diversity of gifts, and there's diversity of ministries, and diversity of effects or operation, but it all proceeds from the same God. There's unity in the Trinity. Then Paul goes on to point out, not only is there unity in the Trinity, but he goes on, look at verse 7. He says, but to each one is given the manifestation of the Spirit for the common good. Now, if the church, the body of Christ, would understand what that one verse meant there in verse 7, 1 Corinthians 12, it would literally revolutionize the ministry of the church. Paul says there, to each one is given the manifestation of the Spirit. To each Christian, to each person who names the name of Christ, who sees Jesus Christ as their personal Savior, they are given the manifestation of the Spirit. The Holy Spirit comes to take residence in every person who believes that Jesus Christ died for their sins on the cross, was buried and raised from the dead on the 3rd day. The Holy Spirit comes, he takes residence in each of those individuals. He manifests himself in each one of those individuals. And why does he do it? Well, we would think he does it for our own personal edification. We would think that he does it for our own personal benefit. That's only secondary. Paul says that the Holy Spirit comes, takes residence inside of you and me, not for my own personal good, not for my own personal benefit. That's secondary. But look what he says. The manifestation of the Spirit for the common good. If you look in the Bible, you'll always see that God is a God who's always dealing with his people in the context of them living in a community with each other. As I've shared with you before, we live in America. We pride ourselves in our individualism, freedom of this, freedom of that, freedom of expression, so forth and so on. We're trying to find our own individual identity. And sometimes that complicates it for us in finding our identity in Christ. Our identity in Christ, we find it not apart from the rest of the body, but we find it in concert with the rest of the body of Christ. He says, God gives you the manifestation of the Spirit for the common good, for the good of the whole body. So what God has done is marvelous wisdom. God creates diversity in the body of Christ so that it forces unity in the body of Christ. Now, I'm going to explain yet what I mean by that a little bit later. God creates diversity within the body. God creates the differences within the body himself. He does that. God creates the diversity so that he then can bring the Holy Spirit to take residence inside of each individual person, to take the ragtag lives, transform it by his Spirit, work in and through them, helping them to exercise their gift to the body of Christ. And as they exercise their gift within the context of the church, that unites them with the rest of the body. And they're able to build up the body by ministering their gift, and the body helps to build up the individual as the body corporately is functioning as the body. How do you follow? So the purpose of the Spirit's gifts to us is to profit, to benefit the body. Therefore, it promotes unity within the body of Christ. Now look at what else he says. For the one is given the word of wisdom through the Spirit, and to another the word of knowledge according to the same Spirit, and to another faith by the same Spirit, and to another gifts of healing by the one Spirit, and to another the effects of miracles, and to another prophecy, and to another the things of spirits, to another the various kinds of tongues, and to another the interpretation of tongues. But one and the same Spirit works all these things, distributing to each one individually, just as he wills. So he starts off by saying there's unity within the Trinity, and that the purpose of the Spirit's gift, the presence in our lives, is to promote unity within the body of Christ. And then he illustrates it in verses 9 through 11. When he starts talking about the spiritual gifts, he's illustrating the principle he's already delineated, the principle that unity should exist within the body of Christ. And the Spirit comes to take residence to manifest himself in the body of Christ for the good of the whole body, to build up and edify the whole body of Christ. And then he illustrates in verses 9 through 11 by delineating certain spiritual gifts and saying no one has all the gifts. But it takes all the gifts being ministered to your life and to mine to bring you and I to spiritual maturity. Are you following? It's sort of like a potluck dinner. And if we get someone to bring the meat, and someone else to bring the vegetables, and someone else to bring the bread, and someone else to bring the dessert, and someone else to bring the drink. Now, everybody has a sign as to what they're supposed to bring. And if each person brings their given a commodity to the dinner, we can have a banquet feast. But if someone shows up shorthanded, there's going to be something missing from the meal. Are you following? That's what Paul is saying here. He's saying God, in his wisdom, he has given the Spirit to every Christian. He's given at least one gift to every Christian. That one gift is not given to the Christian for their own benefit, but is given to the Christian so that they bring something to the banquet feast. So they bring something to the party. So when they bring their gift to the party and they blend their gift with other gifts in the body, then you have a tremendously gifted church, and the whole church then benefits from the mutual operation of the gift in the body of Christ. Are you with me? That's a revolutionary concept for the church, because most people do not take seriously their responsibility to the church, to the body of Christ. We live in America. Most of us live within walking distance of a mall. And so we used to have choices. And so we used to go in and shop. And so when we shop, it's all about what I want. We shop around for what we want, what this out takes, and what we want. And so we approach the church ministry the same way. We think that when we're looking for a church, or when we even out to join the church, we shop around and we pick and choose what we want. It's all about us. No, it's not all about us. It's all about us taking our gift, bringing our gift to the party, exercising our gift, and as we exercise our gift to the body, we have to strengthen the body, and as we strengthen the body is then strong enough to minister to us. Are you helping me up here? We must break out of this paradigm that the church is about me coming, sitting, and soaking in sound, about it being a spectator type of event. No, it's not about being a spectator. This is a participatory activity. And we're all to participate in some capacity. The Holy Thing in 1 Corinthians 12, and turn to Ephesians chapter 4. Ephesians chapter 4. In Ephesians 4, Paul is wanting a similar thing to the church at Ephesus. He is again talking about the importance of unity within the church, within the body of Christ. In Ephesians 4, verse 3, he says, verse 2, with all humility and gentleness, with patience, showing forbearance to one another in love, being diligent to preserve the unity of the Spirit and the bond of peace, there's one body, one Spirit, just as you are all called in one hope of your calling, one Lord, one faith, one baptism, one God and Father of all, who is over all, through all, and in all. There's a whole lot of oneness up there. Amen. I mean, he's emphasizing this with redundancy. That there's one God, one Lord, one Savior, one faith, one baptism. And so we all go into the same heaven if we know the Lord Jesus Christ. Then he goes on to talk about, verse 7, but to each one of us, grace was given according to the measure of Christ's gift. All right, verse 7. So he says, there is oneness, there is unity within the body. But don't get upset. God doesn't have a cookie cutter up where he cut this all out the same. There's unity, but there's still room for individuality. There's still room for diversity. All the women don't have to be Stepford wives. Those who are 4 years old, you know about the Stepford wives. If you're under 40, you don't know about the Stepford wives. But we're not robots, you're not mechanical. God uses us as God created us. And God created us individually. God created us with individual personalities, individual psyches, and makeup. No two people are alike. We all are as different as snowflakes. Are you with me? And God knows that. And some of us are more different than others. And some of us are more odd than others. And God knows that. I shared a message with you a few months ago. We're all a bunch of oddballs. God loves us anyhow. And he knew we were oddballs and he created us. And so there's room for us to express our individuality. That's why Paul in Ephesians 7 says, but to each one of us, grace was given according to the measure of Christ's gift. You see, the grace of God was given to you according to the measure of the gift that Christ has given to you. And as you allow the Lord to work in your life through the Spirit, he will take your personality, your experiences, your background, he will take those things, these poles will come to bear on your life, and then God will arrange those things in your life in such a way to where you can be effective in ministering in the body of Christ. That's why in the church, let me make it plain up in here. In the church, we need some ex-drunks. And we need some ex-drug addicts. And we need ex-prostitutes. And we need ex-adulterers. And we need ex-homosexuals. And we need ex-covetous. And we need ex-liars. We need the full gamut up in here. Because out in the world, sinners are very diverse. And there are sinners in every particular category that you can imagine. And so we need people who are saved by the grace of God out of all of those categories, lives that have been transformed by the power of the Spirit of God, let them feel the Spirit of God, let them have their faith, let them show other folks how to be changed. That's what Paul is trying to help us to see. That when God delivers us from sin, when he gives us the victory, he still keeps us sensitive in that area that held us hostage so that we can relate to and reach other folk and tell them that there's hope for them. I would. Sometimes the church is so saved and so sanctified that we don't want to deal with sinners, but we think for some reason we deal with sinners, we're going to be contaminated by the sin. No, God saves us so that we can work and deal with sinners. Lead them the same faith in Jesus Christ. And he leads them to the good. And so every Christian ought to be taking inventory of their own life. You will take inventory of your own life, and as you examine your own life, the things that God has helped you to overcome in your life, the issues, the habits, the hang-ups that you had to deal with in your life, you should take inventory of those, and the Lord, how can you use me to reach other folks who have the same issues, the same addictions, and the same hang-ups? Paul says to each one of us is given the grace of God according to the measure of Christ's gifts. Now move down to verse 11. He says, he gave some as apostles, and some as prophets, and some as evangelists, and some as pastors and teachers for the equipping of the saints, for the work of service, or the work of the ministry, to the building up of the body of Christ. Now Paul now, he delineates, he says, God gave certain gifted people to the church. And he gave the original apostles, those who had been with Jesus, those foundation stones of the church, those who spent the 3.5 years with him, and those who grounded and rooted the early church, he gave them as gifted people to the church. And he gave the prophets, those who have the ability to speak with prophetic utterance the word of God, and to declare forth the word of God. They're gifted people that God has given to the church, and the evangelists he's given to the church, and the pastors and the teachers he's given them to the church. Don't you realize that you are a gift of God to the church?
Amen.
God gives you saved son, filled with the Spirit of God, endowed with the spiritual gift, he gives you as a gifted individual to the church. And as you discharge your ministry in the local church, you find the purpose and the meaning that you're looking for. You find the sense of destiny and the sense of being involved in something, a part of something that is significant, that is doing significant work in the world. And Paul says, for the perfecting, for the equipping of the saints, so that they can do the work of the ministry, to build up the body of Christ, until we all attain the unity of the faith, verse 13, and of the knowledge of the Son of God, to a mature man, to the measure of the stature which belongs to the fullness of Christ, as a result we're no longer children tossed here and there, to and fro. See, we got a lot of Christians today that they're just tossed to and fro. They're like tumbleweeds blowing through the middle. God's smoke, don't you? Every now and then, Matt Dillon and Festival be out there real serious. Matt was the man. Matt would saddle up on his horse, and always he would end into some ghost town. Criminals hide out in some ghost town. And there'd be tumbleweeds blowing through the ghost town. I could see the dust stirred up there. And he'd flip open the old saloon door, and you could hear all the screeching of the saloon open up. Because the bad guy was always hid somewhere back in the back corner. In an abandoned saloon. So some Christians are like those tumbleweeds on God's part. They don't stay nowhere long enough to get no roots. They don't stay anywhere long enough to get rooted, to get down into a real strong spiritual soil so that they can grow and bring forth fruit. This is serious business, ladies and gentlemen. We're talking about the kingdom of God. We're talking about when you put your faith in Jesus Christ, literally a bullseye was placed on you. Now you become a target of the devil because he never wants you to get angry anywhere, because he never wants you to really understand this whole concept of you being a gifted person to the church and you literally being a tool or weapon in God's hand further the kingdom of God. So he just wants you on from here to there, over here, over there, over here, over there, but never settling down anywhere. And getting angry. I don't have that in here, but I got to do something. You got to get some angers down. And so Paul says he don't want us to be any longer like children, verse 14 of Ephesians 4. Tossed here and there by waves, and carried about by every wind of doctrine, by the trickery of men, by craftiness and deceitful scheming. There's a lot of spiritual deception that's out there. And the enemy's modus operandi is that if he can keep believers confused, disoriented, dysfunctional, then he can keep them from reaching their destiny in Christ. And so some people are just settling for being saved. That ain't enough for me. I just can't settle for being saved. What else does God have for us? We saw about victory this morning. The word is the victory that God has for us. And to get to that victory, we got to be anchored in Christ, anchored in the local church, anchored in the lives of other people who are building into our lives to help us to become all that God wants us to become.
Amen.
Verse 16 of Ephesians 4. Listen to this. He says, from whom the whole body being fitted and held together. By that which every joint supplies. And I got to make a confession right here. Somebody was working on a puzzle in the church. And they were working on the puzzle back here in this back row. And they started putting the puzzle on the table, and they fitting and framing pieces together. And they had the whole outline on the table. I was really planning on coming back and finishing working on the puzzle tonight. But it accidentally got knocked off the table. It accidentally got knocked off the table, so you got to start from scratch. But Paul's analogy here is that of a puzzle. It's fitting together. It's coming together. The pieces fit. The pieces are starting to complement each other, and as the puzzle fits itself together, by the sovereign divine hand of God himself, it starts to take on some image. It starts to look like something. A beautiful picture, some mosaic, some scenery. Are you with me? And so here's what I see. The church is like the pieces of a puzzle inside the box. All the pieces are inside the box. Somebody can come and takes the box and turns over on the table, and now all the pieces are on the table. On the box, there is a picture of what it's supposed to look like. That's the Bible. The Bible is the picture of what we're supposed to look like. Jesus says that upon this rock, I will build my church, and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. Paul says we are the body of Christ, and we are members in particular. We are supposed to start looking like the picture that's on the box. But the only way we can start taking on the likeness of the image that's on the box is we got to come together and let the Holy Spirit flip each of us over on the right side. And as he flips us together, and as we pray together, sing together, testify together, worship together, pray together, plead and beg God together, the Holy Spirit starts to knit us together. And as we start sharing each other's burdens together, agonizing together, holding each other up in prayer together, the Holy Spirit fits and frames us together, and after a while, a bunch of ragtag disciples start to look like a beautiful mosaic. Dress code around here. All we just say, you just come looking decent and in order. And you know what decent and in order is. If you're not decent and in order, I will tell you what decent and in order is. So if you're not decent and in order, I will just tell you that. But I thank God that everybody that's been in this church, you come to the church and you come and dress modestly and you come in decent and in order. And that's wonderful. But you see, I'm from the old school, Brother Keith. Back down in Fayette County, all the sisters here this morning. Matter of fact, she's the first person that took me to Sunday school. And the first one in my family started going to church. And so she would lay out the clothes on Sunday night. And she would polish the shoes and press the clothes and press the church. Because on Sunday morning, you put on your Sunday go to meet stuff. And you look as good as you can on Sunday morning. I believe there's something to the fact that I'm getting ready to go to church. The Lord ain't got a whole lot to work.